Hi, I'm Phil Frieden from IDS Imaging Development Systems, and I'm here to show you how to operate trigger and flash on uEye Plus cameras. Trigger and flash are related topics because they both provide a way to synchronize the image exposure with external devices and processes. Flash is the output signal coming from the camera that signals to other devices that it is currently capturing an image. Trigger is the input signal to the camera that lets the sensor know when it's time to capture an image. Utilizing an electronic connection via the camera's I/O port enables very precise synchronization on the order of a few microseconds. Throughout this video, I will reference wiring diagrams and pin assignment specifications that can all be found on our website by visiting Support, Downloads, and then searching for your specific camera model or item number. After opening the specific downloads page of your uEye Plus camera, the wiring and pinout information are located under Documentation, Specifications, Hardware Description. Additionally, you can look at the IDS Peak manual as a reference for the various camera nodes or parameters that will be configured via software. The Peak manual is also located on the same downloads page under Manual IDS Peak. The flash output signal is not limited to only activating lighting. It can be utilized to synchronize numerous types of external devices, such as PLCs and other sensors. In addition to signaling the image exposure, flash output can also signal other internal camera events, such as image acquisition and sensor readout, or various other internal signals. In the following example, I will demonstrate how to set up a camera to activate a ring light with each image capture. First, it's very important to refer to your exact camera model specifications before applying any voltage to the I/O port of the camera. Many IDS cameras have dedicated flash output pins that are galvanically isolated using an optocoupler to protect the camera and PC from electrical surges. The output of the optocoupler can be used as an open collector or open emitter output, meaning it behaves like a switch that closes when the output signal is active and opens when the output signal is inactive. According to the specifications for this camera and I/O cable, the positive flash output is on pin 5, or the yellow lead, and the negative flash output is on pin 2, or the green lead. Additionally, make sure to consult the specifications of your light, as not all lights work exactly the same. I am following the wiring guide for open emitter output in the hardware manual. I'm using a 24-volt power supply because this satisfies the requirements for both powering the light and powering the flash signal circuit. Mainly, I want to point out that the opto-isolated flash output can handle a maximum of 30 volts, but be careful because certain camera models and I/O pins cannot handle this much voltage. First, I connect the power supply to the positive and negative terminals of the light. Next, I connect the positive flash output, yellow lead, to 24 volts. Then I connect the negative flash output, green lead, to the trigger input of the light. The light trigger input is already grounded from when I connected the light to the power supply. That completes the wiring for this basic flash setup. I open the camera in IDS Peak cockpit where it is capturing images, but the light is not flashing because I did not yet make the necessary software configurations. The easy way to enable flash is by opening the flash dialog in the camera configuration, where we can enable flash and also set delays. Since this is a rolling shutter sensor, I set the flash signal to global flash window, and now I see the light is flashing. I'll disable flash from here to show how to configure these settings under the hood. By clicking on the generic parameters dialog, I have access to all the camera nodes, even including parameters that are not exposed through a dedicated dialog. Here I am searching for the flash nodes, because this is where we set up the internal flash signal that provides the source for activating the flash output on the pins. The flash reference node selects which internal signal to use, and then this signal can be modified via flash start delay and flash end delay. I am setting the flash reference to global flash window and leaving the delays at zero, so the flash signal is active during the entire window when all rows are exposing. Next, I search for the line nodes and select line 1 via the line selector, because this is the dedicated flash output pins. I just need to set the line source to the flash active signal, which I just configured in the previous step. There are other options available, such as user output registers, counters, timers, PWM, and sensor readout. With these nodes set to the correct values, the light is flashing again. A basic flash setup such as this one is beneficial because it provides dedicated illumination for better image quality, can freeze motion blur, and eliminate the rolling shutter effect on moving objects. Trigger is similar to flash, except it is a signal going to the camera instead of coming from the camera. The signal can come from any external trigger source such as light curtains, PLCs, encoders, or other sensors. And it can trigger various events in the camera, such as capturing one or more images, sensor readout, and triggering the exposure of a single line while in line scan mode. In the following example, I will demonstrate how to set up a global shutter camera for trigger timed exposure with a digital signal generator as the trigger input. Trigger timed exposure is a great feature that is available on IDS global shutter sensors in which the exposure time is based on the width of the trigger pulse. I have the camera opened in IDS Peak Cockpit, where I will configure the camera parameters to capture an image where the exposure time is based on the duration of the trigger signal. From the generic parameters section, I search for the trigger nodes and select exposure start under trigger selector. But I need to stop the image acquisition to modify these nodes. I set the trigger mode to on, trigger source to line zero, and trigger activation to rising edge. So now the camera will start the image exposure when a rising edge signal is received on the trigger pins. Next, I select the exposure stop trigger, where I set it to on, line zero, and falling edge. So the camera stops the image exposure when a falling edge signal is received on the trigger pins. I can start the image acquisition again, but the camera is not capturing any images because I have not yet connected it to the digital signal generator. On this camera model, the trigger input is also opto-isolated and accepts a maximum voltage of 30 volts, and the minimum voltage for the high signal is 5 volts. But make sure to refer to your exact camera model specifications before applying any voltage to the I/O port of your camera. Viewing the digital signal on an oscilloscope shows a voltage difference of 10 volts and a frequency of 30 hertz, which is within the specs for this camera. According to the specifications for this camera and I/O cable, the positive trigger input is pin 7, or the white lead, and the negative trigger input is pin 4, or the brown lead. The hardware manual provides the digital input wiring guide, which is pretty straightforward, i.e., connect positive to positive and negative to negative. Following the digital input wiring guide, I connect the positive terminal of the digital signal generator to the positive trigger input white lead of the camera, and then connect the negative terminal of the digital signal generator to the negative trigger input brown lead of the camera. With the wiring completed, I can turn my attention back to Peak Cockpit, where the camera is capturing images. By modifying the frequency and duration of the digital signal, I can change the frame rate and exposure time of the camera. A basic trigger configuration such as this one allows the camera exposure to be precisely controlled by an external device. Now that I demonstrated utilizing the flash and trigger separately, I will put both these concepts together by setting up a primary-secondary configuration. A primary-secondary configuration consists of one primary camera and one or more secondary cameras, in which the flash output of the primary camera is connected to the trigger inputs of the secondary cameras. Whenever the primary camera captures an image, it also triggers the secondary camera to capture an image at the same time. This enables the image capture to occur at precisely the same time for all cameras, which is useful for certain applications such as stereo vision, sports analysis, and many other applications that require multiple angles and precise synchronization. In the following example, I am using a rolling shutter camera for the primary and a global shutter camera for the secondary. Therefore, the light and the secondary camera can both use the primary camera's global flash window as their activation signal. The wiring for the primary-secondary setup is basically accomplished by combining the flash and trigger wiring from the previous examples earlier in this video. The flash output of the primary camera, the trigger input of the secondary camera, and the trigger input of the light are all connected together in series. Since the secondary camera is getting the signal from the primary, the digital signal generator is no longer needed. I am providing the ring light with 24 volts from the power supply. I also connect the positive flash output of the primary camera to 24 volts. The negative flash output of the primary camera is connected to the positive trigger input of the secondary camera. Then, the negative trigger input of the secondary camera is connected to the trigger input of the light, which is then connected to 0 volts. The parameters of the primary camera are the same parameters used in the flash example from earlier in this video. The line source for line 1 is set to the flash active signal, which will activate during the global flash window. The parameters of the secondary camera are the same parameters used in the trigger example from earlier in this video. The trigger input of the secondary camera is configured for a trigger timed exposure. The exposure start trigger is set to a rising edge on line 0, and the exposure stop trigger is set to a falling edge on line 0. With the wiring and software configuration completed, I can see that both cameras are capturing synchronized images and the flash illumination is also working. This example demonstrates that the trigger signal can come from any device, such as another camera, and the flash signal can be used for more than just activating the illumination. With the many available combinations of triggering different camera events and utilizing various internal sources for the flash signal, the world of flash and trigger offers endless creative possibilities that can greatly enhance your machine vision capabilities. Imagine creating robotics applications that require precise visual data, capturing high-speed processes with unparalleled precision, or uncovering details in challenging light conditions. Thanks for joining How to Operate Trigger and Flash on uEye Plus Cameras, brought to you by the IDS Vision Channel.